Housekeeping or one housekeeping. For those of you who haven't looked at your neck wallet yet, there is a card in there that has either the name of Jason, George, or Rima. When you enter in our legislative session later in the week, you will find the table that corresponds with the name on that piece of paper. That's where you'll pick up your voting apparatus. So if you are also a delegate for two, like for your college or for an affiliate organization, you may then have to pick up a second voting apparatus. So, this morning, I have the pleasure of welcoming back one of our former student athletes. Those of you who were in the session yesterday dealing with some information either from the NAIA and some information from the NCAA, we all know that in the sport of football, there are about a little over a million student athletes at high school level playing football. Approximately 13,000 of that million make it to be a senior in college. 250 or so get drafted into the NFL. Now, the odds of a 20-year-old walking on to a two-year college, playing 1 year of football, and having 12 years in the NFL is a story that the odds are just impossible. Our keynote speaker is that person. About his bio, he graduated from Edison High School. He didn't play sports in high school other than freshman football. He attended Golden West College and walked on at the age of 20. He started one season for the Rustlers, was named All-Conference and an All-American, took a scholarship to Arizona, enrolling in the spring of 1988. He started both seasons at right tackle for the Wildcats, was named first team All Pac-10 Conference and All-American after his senior season. He played in the 1990 Senior Bowl. He was drafted in the third round, 69th overall, by the Buffalo Bills in the 1990 NFL Draft. He played seven seasons with the Buffalo Bills and played in four Super Bowls. Played three seasons with the Kansas City Chiefs, was named MVP by his teammates after the 1998 season, the first time in the team's history that an offensive lineman was named an MVP. He played two seasons for the New York Giants, where he played in his fifth Super Bowl. Named All-Madden Team after the 2000 season, he retired after 12 seasons. He's worked with NBC, in the Arena Bowl studio show, the NFL Network, 2 years in Playbook, and Fox Sports Arizona. He's currently working with the Pac-12 Network and four seasons with the Arizona Cardinals post-game show. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Glenn Parker.
I had a PowerPoint, but unfortunately I'm an Apple guy and I'm not really tech savvy, so it didn't work. One of the words you used is the very first string that would have been up. Impossible. I don't think you know what that word means. Do you remember Princess Bride? I don't think this word means what you think it means. That's the truth. So, I still have dreams, once or twice a week. I have dreams that I cannot get to the football field. I have dreams that I can't tie my shoes. I can't get my pads on right. I'm going to panic because I can't get to the field. The game is starting. I'm supposed to be out there. And it's unbelievable that at this age, at 50, I'm still having nightmares about not being able to get to the football field because something's wrong. I got up this morning. I drove here. I pulled off. I got into the parking lot. I grabbed my shoes. And guess what? I had forgotten my socks. Dreams come true. I'm just letting you know, right now. So you'll pardon me as I look down, because this will give me some idea of what I'm talking about as we move forward. So the question is, who am I and why am I here? And the who I am, you heard. The why am I here is not why am I here, it's how did I get here. The why is something else. How did I get here? Who was I? I didn't play football in high school because I wasn't mature enough to play sports. That's the simple truth. I would have been a really good athlete growing up. And at some point, I didn't mature and everybody else did. So I went from being a really good athlete amongst a lot of kids to a mediocre athlete. I wasn't mature enough to handle that. And people don't realize how mature and how organized you have to be to play football in high school, or any sport in high school. It doesn't matter what sport it is. If you're going to dedicate yourself to being a student athlete, it's tough. I wasn't ready for that. About that same time, at that time, what was happening is there wasn't no computers. Video games were in their rudimentary stages. You had Pong and stuff like that. You know, beat that feel exciting. And I got introduced to Dungeons and Dragons, right? So I played a little bit my eighth grade year and going into my freshman year, and I went out for freshman football and I hated it. At the time, I would blame the fact that it was a 300-pound coach telling me I was out of shape. Or I would say my little league coaches when I was 14 got high after practice in the dugout. Those are crutches. It was me that failed, not them. I'm responsible for me. So I wasn't mature enough to realize that I was no longer really good. And so I got into this world. I did D&D, but I'm not a fantasy type person. Like, I'm not a techie. I have to do. I like to do. I like to have the action. So I said, well, where can I do something like this, but for real? So I joined a group called the Society for Creative Anachronism. And I was 14 or 15, maybe a little closer to 16. And what they do is they dress up in armor and hit people with sticks. Not foam, nothing, real sticks. Try to break each other's armor and smash and dent it. I loved it. So this is cool. And during that group and in that time, I learned a lot about people. And I didn't realize I learned a lot about people until I reflected upon it as I got older. Because it was a group of misfits, people that for whatever reason, they might have been a real success in society, but in that group they couldn't be successful for whatever reason. Or they might have been a complete nerd or geek in society, but in that group they were really well thought of because they could do something really special. And some of those people, it might be as simple as they could do calligraphy or illustrations that would be used in museums. You can't make a living doing that. But they could be really well thought of in that group. So what I found, I remember looking back, you have to find the beauty in everybody. Because every person out there, no matter who they are, no matter what their station in life, if you can find the beauty in them, if you can find what it is that they deserve respect for, because they do, I can look at somebody and go, that guy doesn't deserve my respect when it comes to diet or exercise choices. Or that person's personal hygiene does not deserve my respect. Their fashion sense is a no. But something about it deserves respect, and there's beautiful things about everybody. I learned that lesson. I was only in that group for 4 years or so. I got to where I was actually the top of the group, the best of the people fighting. You know, I got to be the best of the best, 50,000 people fighting. I was the best. And I started thinking to myself, well, I want to be a success, not just, this is fun, this isn't life. I'm going to junior college, I'm taking a class here and there, I'm not a success, I want to go to college and I want to get a degree. So I found that if I applied the lesson of find beauty in everybody, and everybody deserves respect, it's going to come back to me. In ways that I did not predict when I was 14, 15, 16. But now that I'm 50, I can look back and go, wow, I can't believe those things happen. And a lot of it was simply because that group of nerds and misfits, I learned from. And today, it's easy to be that person because the internet has made a community for everybody. But there was no internet. You had to find your family of nerds and misfits, and I was one of them. So I find the beauty in people. I respect. I find what to respect about them because we all have them. And it's going to be, it'll shock you sometimes what some people are really capable of doing. Everybody has a geeky. Everybody's geeky about something, you know. It could be you're geeky about Mr. Gasparian. It could be you're geeky about the number of stitches per inch on a volleyball and the flight. That's geeky. Trust me. It's just a volleyball to most of us, but you've got it going. Or you're into golf and the angle of the head has got to be some geeky. All right? That's okay. Because everybody has that. Everybody's so passionate about that one little thing. And once you realize that about people, you've got a bond. You've got something common with them. And you might not be geeky about the same things, but once you realize we're all like that, then that really leads to the respect factor a lot easier, and you can learn, and you can grow from these people. And I kind of found that out upon reflection, and I realized that's what had happened to me. So when I went out for football, and by the way, see, armor smashing each other up. I did that. I was embarrassed by it for a lot of years. I don't care. I learned. I look at it as I grew a lot from those people. I found a community of people who didn't judge you based on what you could accomplish, but more importantly, what you were interested in and who you were. And that was new for me. And I say everybody's geeked about something. Okay, I'm an info junkie. I read voraciously. As a kid, I read encyclopedias because I wanted information. I had a radio show. You can't be wrong on the radio. People will find you out, and they'll call in, and they're going to mail you. Can't be wrong. So every morning, I still have a habit. Get up and I read every website about football and about the rumors that are going on and who's going where. And I pick up about different offenses and defenses. I don't want to be wrong in that situation. I had to be right. So I'm a info junkie. I have thousands of books in my home. I'm a junkie and a nerd when it comes to wine. Because I got into wine while I was playing. I started working in a winery. I started teaching at the winery. I'm a nerd about wine. I'm a nerd about pocket watches and arts and crafts furniture. I can go on because everybody's got those weird little things that they love. So embrace your geek. That'll help you be better across the board. It's true. It's going to pay you back. I promise you it'll pay you back. When I was a kid, there was a change problem on our refrigerator. And I stared at it every day. And I put it in my kids' lunches to this day. Once in a while, I throw it out so they can think about it. And there's an old Chinese proverb that says, hey, there are many paths to the top of the mountain, but the view is always the same. And I don't know what that meant. I probably still don't know what it means, but I love it. Why? Because it tells you that you're not wrong. You didn't fail, you just changed paths. And when you get to the top of the mountain, everybody will eventually get to the top of that mountain. And your view's gonna be the same as anybody else up there. So there's no right or wrong path. And that taught me quite a bit. It taught me that you have to understand that opportunity is going to knock. That you pick this path, and you're walking, and opportunity knocks. My dad always said, yeah, it knocks, got to be smart enough to open the damn door. And a lot of people are afraid to open that door, right? They don't know. I'm going this way. There's only one way to go, and I'm going there. Well, no, a lot of ways to go. Listen. Hear what they have to say. Pick it, maybe not, maybe you do it, but open the door. If you don't open the door, you never really understand that what could really be possible. Opening the door and picking your path, that's all really ways of talking about being an athletic person, being agile, and being able to adapt. Because it's an amazing thing when people say, oh, he's a dumb job. That guy's a dumb job, or a dumb football player, or they're not very smart. Can you imagine if you had to ask a physicist to explain what happened when Steph Curry drove the lane and as he was going up, this came in. If he doesn't adapt, if he's not agile, he gets swatted and he never makes the NBA because he's constantly doing the same thing and failing at the same thing over and over again. But he'll go up, switch hands, put it over here. He changes the directory, the launch point, how much speed and what the arc is. Now that just comes natural. His brain tells him to do that. It's not his body doing that. When you're an athlete, it's your brain telling your muscles to do that. That's a form of intelligence. And so I would love to have a physicist try to figure out all those moves and what that did and how it worked and how it went through the brain. That's the ability to be agile and adapt. And everybody has it in some way or form. You're moving through. You hit obstacles. What do you do with the obstacles? Where do you go with these obstacles? Athletes naturally have it within a physical parameters, but it's now how do you make it where it's a life, where it's part of your life, that you can be agile and adapt and change. I would say this. The number one thing holding people back is they fear failure. They don't want to adapt and change because they fear failure. You cannot fear failure. Coaches know. When you're teaching someone, you want to replicate the success. We want to learn from our failures. Learn the failure. When you replicate failure over and over and over again, the same way, okay, now we got a problem. But if you're learning from your failures, the sky's the limit. That's where we have growth. That's where we learn. That's where players get better. And coaches know that. Coaches can talk to a player, and if they see right away whether this player is attempting to get better and switch the failure up, or is he just replicating the failure? Now we know the difference, right? So number one, don't fear failure. I walked into a football locker room at the age of 20. I didn't know how to put on the pads. I was watching, you know, for anybody who's played football out there, you have a tail pad. It's about that big. It goes right here. Made a lot more sense in my mind to go right here. Put that there. I would walk around the field, you know, you don't wear cups in football. That was new. And I was a little trepidatious walking out of that field. Whoa. You know, I'm thinking, I just thought it was natural you wore a cup. I didn't know how to put on the pads. I didn't speak the language. I got into meetings, they're talking front side, back side, splits, this. And my head is spinning. I have no idea what they're talking about. I didn't know what front side meant or back side meant or this split or was I tight to the line. It was a language I had to learn. If I had feared failure, I would have never done it. Instead, I embraced it. And that's where you get, that's the next part. Leave your ego at the door. Anybody's done martial arts? I took up jiu-jitsu upon retiring from the NFL. I wanted to get into submission wrestling just for fun. I ended up going to tournaments and I won the Pan Americans and like anything I do, I tend to go a little crazy with it. My wife hates me for that. You know, I'm compulsive when it comes to trying new things and I put it in. We all at the gym at the same time. Leave your ego at the door. You're gonna tap 1,000 times. You're gonna get beat over and over and over and over again. And the people that learn from it, they move up the line. They get better. It's the people that replicate the failure over and over, they don't learn from it. So don't fear failure. Leave your ego at the door. Admit you know nothing. The fastest way to learn anything in this world is to admit you know nothing. If you think, I know a little bit, that's an anchor. That's dragging down, man. You'll never learn. Because you always have a pre-notion of what you think is happening. I walked in there and I had coaches thank God to help me. I admitted that I knew nothing. And I started over at the age of 30 with the Kansas City Chiefs. I had played the same offense at Golden West for that year and in 7 years with the Bills. Same offense. I got to Kansas City and they're running a new offense. And it wasn't just new, it was the West Coast, which as you know now, everybody runs. Every team in the NFL runs a version of the West Coast game. It was a whole new language. So, how did I approach it? I took a pen, I took a paper, and every single word the head coach, the offensive coordinator, the defensive coordinator, my offensive line coach, I wrote down. And in the course of my first 3 or 4 weeks, I had 4 journals full. Every meeting, title, date, time, what was said, and I transcribed. I learned the language by immersion. And that's admitting you know nothing, right? That's what you do. Hey, I'm gonna go to Spain. I don't speak Spanish, but I'm gonna immerse myself. And that's how you learn. So leave that ego at the door. And when you're talking to kids, so much of it is getting them to understand. Don't have your ego. Don't let your pride play. Let's figure this way out. And that is just hugely important. And finally, you know, you've got the what ifs and the what thens. The Guide to Rational Living is a great book because it teaches you. You make rational choices. Everybody makes them, but we like to blame some decisions on others. Well, I'm living in Arizona because my wife wants to. I don't mind. No, I'm living in Arizona because I want my wife to be happy. And I made the decision to make her happy and move to Arizona rather than Huntington Beach, California. Would I rather live in Huntington Beach? No, because that would mean my wife is unhappy, and I don't want my wife to be unhappy. I like my wife. The what ifs and the what thens. So, you know, in jiu-jitsu, we call it the what then. Okay, I'm going to set up this arm bar, and he can, if I hit it right, I tap it. But he can escape these two ways. So that leaves me then these other ways to react when he does that. So it's like a tree, it just branches out like that. That, every, you know, when you are worried about failure, just think to yourself, all right, what if I take this job? Well, what then? And you know, you ask yourself, well, I could be a success, or I, you know, it could be a total failure, and I hate it. Well, what then? You already have a job you love. In the NFL, we say, hey, I was looking for a job, and I found this one. You know, you get cut all the time, and then you get cut, you move to the next team, and off you go. You can't worry about it. So the what ifs and the what thens are your way of making sure your decision's rational, that you've done all you can do to make it a good decision, but then you've got to take action and do it. Because decisions, everybody has those. How many people here said, first year, I'm going to lose weight. I'm going to go lose weight. I'm joining the gym. But then they don't do it. Decisions plus actions give you the results. Decisions alone, you're spinning your wheels. You're not doing anything. Don't be afraid of fear. Leave your ego at the door. Take some action, man. That's what it's all about. And finally, look at situations. Are you a person who, when you look at a situation, do you look to see what you can gain? Or do you look to see what you can add? If you're the type of person who looks to see if you can gain, you're a taker. And that's short-term success. If you look to see what you can add, that's long-term success, it's helpful to other people, and a lot more will happen for you. I was in the locker room when I first got to New York. A young producer for MSG Network was hustling around, and throughout that year, he'd come in and say, could you be the coach's show today? And I would have been on that coach's show seven times in 1 year, and in a 17-week season. I'm like, don't you get tired of having me on? He goes, well, no, because, we're supposed to have Tiki Barber, but he didn't show, he's not ready. Okay, so I get dressed, comb my hair, sponge my hair. Still living like I'm 17, I swear. But I would just do that. That was kind of my prep. Okay, he wants me, I'll do this show. Well, I get an interview to do an audition, I should say, for NBC. I'm going to do college football, I'm going to do arena football on the weekends out of the studio. And I went to this audition, and I thought, it'll be fine. And I was really pumped for the interview until I got there. And I got to the audition, I got Michael Irvin, I got Terrell Davis, I've got all these all-stars, wide receivers, quarterbacks. And you got a bunch of schlubby offensive linemen. One of these things is not like the other guys. I'm like, all right, well, I go through the audition. It was awesome. I thought I did a nice job, but you never know. So I'm hanging back. I go home. And 2 weeks later, I get a call. And it's the producer. Hey, love to have you. His name was Sam Plunk. He's now head of production for NBC. And so we'd love to have you. They thought you did a great job. You really killed it. I said, wow, okay, great, thanks. So I fly out to New York City, and I go to a meeting. And I'm in this meeting, and the head, at that time, head of sports production, asked me to sit down. He goes, Glenn, you killed the audition. Thank you. I said, can I ask a question? Why was I in this audition? I said, you had Michael Irvin, who also worked with me there. He was the other person I hired. And I went through Trudell Davis and Billy Joe Tolliver and these quarterbacks. Why was I on this audition? He looked at me and said, you don't remember? No. Because I was the producer of the coaches show 4 years ago. You were always ready to go. And you always took an interest in me and asked me about my life and what was going on. It'll pay you back in ways you don't know. It really will. Thank you very much, guys.
Well, we have plenty of time for questions. And I guess the first question I'll ask. What caused you to look at Golden West as an opportunity after not playing high school football? And what did you take away from Golden West when you went to Arizona?
So Golden West, first off, for me, I chose Golden West coming out of Edison High School because everybody in Edison went to Orange Coast. Honestly, that's the reason. Everybody went to OCC and I said, I do not want an extension to high school. I believe in reinventing yourself. I think it's important as a person to reinvent who you are periodically, to sometimes maybe to rediscover your passions, but also to further your education. For whatever reason, reinvent. So I wanted to reinvent myself after high school. I had been that nerd who dressed up in armor and hit people, and I wanted to maybe change who I was. So I went there simply for school, and because it was different than OCC. Now, what a blessing it was, because I ended up playing basketball in the courts and whatnot. And I used to play down at Edison Community Center, and I had one time I met and played basketball with Sidney Wicks. And he said, man, you're a great athlete. You ought to be doing something. And my best friend in the world was playing at Stanford at that time. He grew up four doors down from me. He was an All-American at Edison. He played baseball and football for Stanford for 4 years and went to the 49ers. And didn't quite make it, but that's a story in itself. We grew up four doors down from each other. We're still best friends to this day. And he said, you ought to be playing football or something. You're too good an athlete. Because I wasn't an athlete the last time they saw me, I was 14. So when I, here I was, and I, yes, I could dunk a basketball. I was 280 pounds, and I will be the first to admit I'm somewhat of a genetic freak. The first time I hit the weight room, I benched over 300. I'm the type that I, even now, I don't lift a lot of weight. I don't lift weights a lot because I gain too much muscle and I get too big and I'm too old for that. I want to try to stay small. So I still am strong. I stay away from it. So I was blessed in that I had people that wanted me to go out. And then by sheer luck, when I walked up to talk to the coaches, the head coach wasn't there. I wanted to play tight end or D lineman. I was pretty certain that's, of course, I knew nothing about the game. I didn't know where I might fit, but I was like, I'm a D lineman or a tight end. They catch the ball, they get the girls, it'd be awesome. By sheer luck, I walked into Dennis Dixon's office. And Dennis Dixon, for who he was the greatest single junior college offensive line coach going. Every year he put guys in D1 spots. Every year those guys went to D1. When I say D1, it was SEC, it was Pac-12, it was big time players who started with those programs. The years before me, guys started at Florida, then Ole Miss, and Texas A&M. And so by sheer luck, I had that. And then I'm really blessed, and I'll go on with a short one. At that age in a kid's life, I don't care who you are, young men and young ladies at that age are in a tempest. It's a hurricane of emotions and hormones going through their body at the age of 20. And no matter how much my father was the strongest person in my life, sometimes at that age, young men don't want to listen to their fathers. And I had a beacon by the name of Ray Shackelford who expected things of me, made me answer to what he wanted. He wasn't tough about it. He wasn't like the voice. He wouldn't yell. He never got mad. But boy, you knew when you crossed him. And it didn't have anything to do with anything he said. You just knew, oh boy, I've done something wrong. And because of Ray, because of Coach Shackelford, I could get to the NFL. And what I took was business. When I went to Arizona, I took, you do your business, you handle yourself like a man, you don't offend people, you don't hurt people, and you work hard. There's no reason to simply be a character, just to be a character. Anyone else? I couldn't have spoken that well.
You've had a great opportunity to play for a lot of coaches. Can you share some highlights with us of lessons you've learned from some of your coaches? Obviously, you touched on that with Coach Shackelford, but some other ones.
Yeah, at first I was lucky that Dennis Dixon taught me the game from the outside in. So many kids who come out of high school, and so many guys I played with in the NFL, they understood I've got this guy, or I've got this guy and maybe that guy. Coach Dixon taught me the mental part of the game of understanding safeties are here, linebackers are here, if the safeties shift, what are we looking at? So I have a much deeper understanding of the game from the very get-go, and that's a coach who made a big difference. At that same school, I had Alex Gerke, who has since been a coach at Utah and SMU and Hawaii and whatnot. He taught me the emotional side of the game and how to take nasty to the field. That's not something a lot of people naturally have, but he taught me how to bring it. And a highlight is because in one game against Long Beach City, they had a guy who had already signed a big-time scholarship. He had 5 sacks the week before, and I was a left tackle going against him. And I beat him within an inch of his life. And he ended up getting hurt. And the highlight was that I learned how to be nasty. But the highlight was because Ray Shackelford sat me aside and said, that's not how we play the game. I love the ferocity. I love what you, but we don't play the game that way. I felt bad. I still feel bad that I hurt that guy. I didn't mean hurt him. It was just in the process of playing hard. That I learned a lot of lessons right in one game from two coaches. Both good. Both things I needed to learn. And that's huge. And then, you know, as you move through, you learn never to give up. You learn, you know, I learned that at Arizona, I learned that the last play, no matter how good it was, I could be better the next one. If I ran 70 yards to make a play, I'll run 75 the next time. And that's what got me to the NFL was that. And then in the NFL, I think the biggest highlight for me, on a personal note, it had nothing to do with wins or losses. It had nothing to do with a performance. What it was is Andre Reed caught a ball over the middle about 35, 40 yards deep. And as he was running, the ball popped out. He got hit. And I was there to get the fumble. And at the post game, they asked Coach Mark Levy, they said, isn't it lucky that Glenn Parker was there to get that fumble? You guys could go on to win the game. And he responded, no, luck has nothing to do with it. If there was such a thing as luck, that how come bad teams are never lucky? He goes, why don't we watch the film of practice every day and what's Glenn Parker doing? All the offensive linemen are sprinting to the ball. He's doing what he was coached to do. That was a highlight for me. Because it didn't highlight, oh, he's fast or he's big. It highlighted that I was doing exactly as I've been trained to do by Marv Levy, who was one of the better, if not the greatest coach I've had. Yes, sir.
Yeah, Glenn, what's your view on concussion now?
Well, okay, I'm of two minds, and so I hope I don't speak out of both sides of my mouth here, which I'm going to, so please listen. The NFL knows, knew, and hit it, plain and simple. And for young men who come up from the age of 12 playing the game where they're taught to listen to their trainers and coaches, and then they go to college where they're taught to listen to their trainers and coaches, because the trainers and coaches have their best interest at heart. To when they get to the NFL, when the trainers, the coaches, and the doctors are now in the employ of the organization, which does not have your best interest at heart, it's a very tough transition for them. Those young men have a hard time, particularly if they're very good football players. They're indoctrinated in the system, and they're kept there. So the NFL knew, and they lied about it. Plain and simple, that's the way it is. Personally, I didn't play till I was 20, and I'm pretty sure I already knew that hitting my head into another human being's head was not good for me. I'm pretty sure, I'd like to think I was that smart. You know, my wife might disagree, but I would like to think I knew better. And so they're a part of the game. I think, for me, I do not advocate children playing until they get to high school. I don't like Pee Wee All-American. The coaches, I do not believe, know enough of the game to teach it responsibly. I think they're too often they're playing a part. They're not actually being a coach. They're acting a coach. My own son, I have not let play. He's becoming a freshman, and he still knows I might not let him if he doesn't grow up. He's kind of like me. He's a little slow to the grow up. I believe that the longer you wait, because the CTE study by Harvard has pointed out, there is a very strong correlation. Now, we all know correlation is not causation, but there's a very strong correlation with concussions before the age of 13 and CTE and post-NFL players. So that's my take. Was that both sides? Okay.
Glenn, playing in the NFL, thank you for being with us.
Oh, thank you.
I appreciate it. Playing in the NFL, the level of performance and the constant level of performance that's expected of a player at that level, is there something you did to mentally prepare for that event? I mean, every...
Yeah. There is, and thank you for asking. My college roommate, Chris Nearman, is with me right here today. He came down here. We were talking about it prior to coming in here. I believed strongly that I had to have a life and friends outside of football. In college, it's easy to have your friends in football because it's college, it's who you are. But I didn't want to be defined. My life was not going to be, I'm a football player. I played football, but I'm not going to be that. So I have rule number one. Rule number one, all of my friends knew, and all my friends were non-football players, and it speaks, this is my college roommate, he didn't play sports, he was an engineering student who stayed up all night on a computer. I didn't even know how to turn on a computer, that'll give you that. But all of my friends, I made sure, were people in the community. You know, some guys were contractors, some guys were bartenders, some guys were teachers. We were a good group of friends, and rule number one is we don't talk football. And now, as a group we could, but people would come up and want to talk football. No, you come down and have a beer. Go sit down, let's have a beer. But we're not talking football. I wanted my sanity. I wanted to be away from that game for the 12 hours that I didn't have to be there. Because you have to get there at 6 in the morning, and a lot of times you're not leaving and getting home until 7 or 8 at night. And the last thing I want to do is be then thinking about football all night. So that was my strategy. And then to get ready for level of play, leave no stone unturned. So on game day, well, the day before the game, I'd have my coach walk through every possible blitz against every possible protection. And then game day, I would go through every play, every defense, and visualize myself
with a perfect block. And that was how you deal with it. At least that's how I dealt with it. I never wanted a coach in my life until the last like 3 or 4 years. I didn't have the patience. So God bless coaches and you guys for understanding that, that you want to do this. But going back now and coaching, what I've learned, and it's been really helpful because I do little kids, 12-year-olds. I do high school kids, and I also train college kids for the combine. Everybody learns differently. And a coach sometimes gets caught up in the idea that they have a way of doing things. And sometimes that's not the way. There's another path up that mountain. And find out how he learns. I've done this in high school. We have a kid, he could not possibly learn the defense. He can't do it. Well, I went to the learning specialist. I said, how's he learn? Oh, he learns by touch. So every time I coached him, I grabbed his arm and I put him where he needed to be and I taught him that way. He learned it. Everybody learns differently, so the coach needs to look at his performance, not the players. Because a lot of times it's the coach who's too strongly suited with a certain way. The best coaches in the world are rigid, but they're not unbending. And that's at odds with each other, but it's very much the truth. You can have a very strong structure of what you expect from people, but you really need to bend the way you teach them because they all learn differently.
What's your current career like? What's your level of preparation? What's a day like today, these days?
Well, I've already done it. I was up at 4 this morning. I get all the news because my career now is I coach in the off season. I do clinics and I coach kids and coaches how to coach football and play football. And then I have all the spring games for the Pac-12 plus the Cardinals coming up. So I still keep my hand very much 2 or 3 hours in the off season going over every football story, going over every bit of information that's out there about football, whether it be gossip or more importantly news and transactions to know what's going on. And then in the course of a week, I'm watching every game film of the coming teams. And then I'll watch cut-ups of teams that play like them to get ideas of what they're going to do. And I always go back to basics right before the season. I act as if I don't know anything about football, and I might go to the Saints, or I might go to University of Arizona or Arizona State, and I sit in with the coaches and I say, all right, pretend I know nothing about the game, teach me your defense. Because that way I learn it from the bottom up and I can understand it a little better. So it's a lot of prep work during the week for a game. It's constant. It's every day and many hours a day.
Just a fun question. In your career, who was the best player you ever played against or played with?
Best player I ever played against, Howie Long. Incredibly explosive, off the ball so fast that he was into you before you set, so he could throw you. Now, the best player I ever played with was also the best I ever played, and that's Bruce Smith. Bruce Smith not only had that explosion, but he had incredible balance. And so he was able to really take advantage of it. And I will always say this, Howie Long, by the way, and I kind of know him through friends now, we talk a little bit. He was a guy that one game, and I'm not kidding you, he'd have had 8 or 9 sacks. He just couldn't tackle. He beat me so bad, it was the worst beating I ever took on a field. And thank God he couldn't tackle, because he'd have had so many sacks. It's like, oh. But Bruce Smith, on the other hand, a guy I really never got along with, as my own teammate, he's the best I've ever seen. And the guy just was incredible, balance, work ethic like none others, never ceased to prepare, got himself in shape. Was always in shape, just an incredible, incredible specimen of a person, of a pro football player.
Do you have a vision of being a coach in the NFL?
No, I would maybe like to be an offensive line coach. That's just, I know that I know where I am now and who I am now, and I know I'm not done. You know, it's so interesting. A lot of people say, oh, you're 50, you're done. Well, you know, I always say, Robert Mondavi, you guys into wine at all? Anybody know Robert Mondavi? He was 53, he was dead broke, and he started the first winery in California since Prohibition. Well, he died in his 90s of multi-billionaire. He wasn't done. I'm not done at 50, I might just change paths. I'm gonna take another path. Some other door's gonna open. I'm gonna adapt, I'm gonna be agile, and I'm off I go. So, coaching, maybe.
Yeah, you played the 4 Super Bowls with Bill, that home run was pretty remarkable. You guys still get together as that group of guys?
do. It's usually, it's recently it's been around the Hall of Fame, because so many guys are going into the Hall of Fame that, that every August seems like it's a reunion of the Hall of Fame. It's a lot of fun. You know, we're all better than we used to be.
Being a junior college student first and taking that route, when you got to the four-year level, and even in the pros, I don't think people really realize how many professional athletes, especially in the NFL, came from the JCs because they don't get a lot of notoriety for that.
Right.
You find a common bond with certain guys.
Absolutely. Absolutely, we did. The Ed Block Courage Awards. One year featured, the Ed Block Courage Award is an NFL award given by the trainers to the players who on each team that overcome injury and play the most inspirational football. And I won it one year for the Kansas City Chiefs. And I was there with Derek Dees, who played at El Camino, and Aaron Cromer, who played, I want to say Long Beach City. Three of us had won the award. Three of us were in the same limo from the same hotel, and all three of us had played junior college in Southern California and all got in the NFL. And two of us didn't play high school football. Derek Dees didn't play either. So, how about that? And what I like, what I tell, you know, going back to the whole junior college thing, the professors and coaches at junior college are the best I ever had. College coaches are, it's all about, we have to win now, and can we get this done and go? Professors in college don't care. And when I went back to get my degree finished, I made sure that I took certain subjects at junior college because those professors cared. They want you to do well. They're there every day. A college professor, you're lucky if he's in his office when he says he's going to be there. He doesn't know you. You're just a number who pays the bills. Junior college is the greatest experience I've had, and I have the utmost respect for the coaches and professors there, and I say that over and over again. So, we definitely bond, the JC guys, because we know what we went through to get there.
As a football fan, how a team and how those individuals could go four times and not reach the goal that obviously they were playing with, how do you deal with that?
Well, first off, Marv Levy was fantastic at getting us ready and mentally prepared. Marv Levy was the type of, every year's team is different. A different team. We like to say, well, the Bills did it 4 years in a row, but that was four different Bills teams that did it. Marv Levy and a few of us were the constants, but most huge turnover in numbers. The one thing is you prepare every week to win. And when it's over, it's over. Now we prepare for the next game. And he used to sing Civil War songs, and it was amazing, man. He had all these one more river to cross. He kept us focused on what was most important. And that was the next item, not the last one. It's over, move on, let's go, let's get out here. My roommate tells a story. Super Bowl, he goes down, he comes into the party afterwards, everybody's glum. You know, guys are like this, he comes to my table, it's a party. I've got a plate full of shrimp. Hey man, nothing I can do about that now. Let's have fun, let's win the party. That's Marv Levy talking, that's not me, that's Marv Levy. We're gonna win this party, we're out there right now. So, you guys remember Rob Gronkowski, the famous pictures after the loss, dancing, going crazy? He's a friend of mine. He went to Arizona, and I kind of was with him through. And I said, hey, it's a tough loss. I know what it's like. Go win the party. He texts me back, and all that comes out. He goes, I did like you said. What happened?
Thank you. It's
kind of a long question, but in your experience, like, and looking back in hindsight, I was a strength and conditioning coach at USC. We won national championships during that time. We had a great, amazing team. Lots of them went to the NFL, but a lot of them didn't. And now I help out at a community college. I'm a strength and conditioning coach for the athletes there. A lot of them aren't going to go to the NFL, right? So, but I don't want to tell them that. I want to believe, you know, shoot for your dream. But in looking back in hindsight, all the lessons you've learned as an athlete, showing up, working hard, determination, discipline, you have to apply those to education as well. Sometimes they hear you, sometimes they don't, right? So looking back in hindsight, you were with junior college student athletes. How would you best communicate to them the the importance of the little things in everything that they do, in school, showing up, because we're all from different cultures.
Right.
All people have different support at home than other people do, where they will hear you and then take action.
So in your milieu, you know, you're right in the weight room. Nobody jumps up and hits four plates. They start with a 2.5 and they start. That's the little things. You can't get strong in the weight room without building towards it. You can't get to the NFL without building towards it. It's little steps. You're strongest on a football field with short, choppy steps. That's when you're at your strongest. You're strongest if you build a good foundation. So however you can get in their head and find what it is that they learn from and how they learn, and you have to change who you are sometimes to do that, is get them to understand that the NFL is a goal and a dream. But like John Wooden said, you know, you can't be perfect, but if we strive for perfection, which is the NFL, we can reach excellence. So if they strive for that and they do what's necessary, you can give them the blueprint to get to the NFL and know that the byproduct of following that blueprint is most likely going to be the path that they take. It's not actually going to get to the NFL. They don't necessarily need to know that. I mean, they won't believe you if you tell them that. But you say, here's how you have to get to the NFL. Here's what you have to do. And when they do those things, no matter where they actually end up, they'll have that base and they'll be successful because of that. So it's that, again, it's that door opening that they probably didn't think was going to open for them. And it'll lead to some career they're not even thinking about at this point. So I never thought of the NFL until my senior year in college. My whole reason to go off to football is to get a scholarship so I can pay for my college. I paid at Golden West on my own. I didn't have money to pay for a regular college. So I said, well, I'll play football, get a scholarship there. I'll get the scholarships. It'll be great. And I got the scholarship. I played in Arizona. And then all of a sudden, going into my senior year, all these things came out saying I was one of the top tackles in the country. Put the education aside, let's go for the NFL right now. I've got a chance. I'm going to go for it. You know, and some people say that's not smart, but when you're told by the NFL scouts that you're that close, well, maybe for me it was a smart decision. So for them, it's to go to the NFL. Here's the blueprint for success to get there. And the byproduct would be some thing that they end up doing that they needed all that base for. I hope that answered your question.
Yeah.
That's how I handle it.
Thank you.
What do you think the state of high school football is right now? I know the participation is decreasing. Where do you see the future of high school football?
Well, I think it's decreasing. Obviously, there's this backlash against concussions and this, you know, we live in a society in which the safety crazies have taken over, you know. We used to run around with a slingshot and BB gun and have fun. And now you'd be arrested. Go figure. You know, you have to wear a helmet when you go to the dinner table because the chair's too tall. Right? It's just ridiculous what's happened. We're so afraid that something's going to happen. Well, we drank out of vinyl hoses and we survived, you know. We hiked in the sugar cane and at the Santa Ana River or whatever that cane was, and we survived. So I think that's part of the problem right there. Participation down because there's a natural backlash against the sport because number one, it is a violent sport, and there's the safety people. And then number two, I think it's the fact that it's the most popular sport. There's always backlash against what's most popular. People define themselves by what they're not. You know, I like all sorts of music, but rap. Well, why would you define yourself because you don't like rap? Why don't you tell me what you do like? And I can manage from there. So I think that's part of the problem. I think the other problem with high school football is that high school football players are not being prepared to play college football. There's certain positions, offensive line, defensive line, DB, that are not ready when they get to college. And the colleges don't have a chance to get them ready because they got to win now. The money's so big, they have to win now, so they don't develop this talent. And that's why we talk about the lamentable state of offensive line play and DB play in the NFL, because nobody's learning. And the problem is, I think that either the NFL is going to have to change, which they will not do, because they're never going to go to big old giant rosters. High school and college is going to have to change and bring their hash marks in tight. And they're going to have to go to a more NFL style of game that's cleaner, tougher, more diet. And they're going to have to let coaches be with players, not in pads, but give them some more time so they can develop these kids. Because right now, they just can't get to the NFL. And ultimately, if they feel as if they can't get there, they're going to stop playing.
We've all watched Jim Kelly in public, struggle to challenge. Facing cancer, and listening to you and how, you know, your recollections of Coach Lee.
Yeah. Yeah, they have. You know, as a team, we've come together around him, and it's interesting because he was not the most likable human being as a player. Not all of us liked him. You know, he wasn't like a lot of us. But as he faced struggles in life, the one that, you know, outside of Buffalo, not a lot of people know he had a son born with Krabbe's disease, which he had had a daughter, he really wanted a son, they had the son, and it was a disease that would kill the son ultimately at the age of 10, but usually it's by 2. And that changed him. And then the cancer changed him, and he became somebody we actually liked and rallied around. And that's an amazing transformation for somebody who, when he was at his best, you maybe liked him okay, but he was just that guy. And through his struggles, he changed, not us. It didn't make us more wanting to like him. He became a person we liked. And so we've really rallied around him through this time, and he's beaten it. And I'm happy for him on a personal level that he's become a better person. Yeah, the number one reason football players wind up in trouble financially is that their career is tiny. We all hear about the guy who got the big contract and he's broke, but understand this, that the average career right now, the NFLPA says 2.8 years, the NFL says it's 3.2. But if you take guys like me out that played more than 10, it drops to less than 1 year. So most guys get in, they get a few games under their belt, they're cut, and they never play again. So when they go bankrupt, that counts as an NFL player being bankrupt. Well, he might have made 50 grand. And the government nailed him because under what his income was supposed to be was high. So he gets hit. Because also, people don't realize this, when you're in the NFL, when you play out of state, every city you play, every state you play, you have to pay taxes to. Because they know where you were and that you worked there. And they nail you on it. You'll file 18 forms. It's unbelievable how much you have to do. So the broke problem is really, you have to look at the big-time players that made a lot of money. I went in with the thought process, I wanted to play 3 years. I thought I had a 3-year contract, so I want to play 3 years, I want to save enough money to get a condo in Huntington Beach, and I'm going to surf the rest of my life. I love surfing. A few things I do, hey Ray, there will always be baseball? No, there's always surfing. Surfing is my constant. So that's what I wanted. So I bought an F-150 pickup truck, stripped, it had nothing on it, roll-up windows, and I drove that to my eighth year in the league. And so I didn't have anybody tell me, I just knew I didn't want to be broke. I just knew every bit I got was going to go away. And so then I started making more and getting bigger contracts, and you loosen the strings a little bit, even in my last year, right? Even now I drive a station wagon, a car, you know, I just want to make sure I'm never broke. So no one ever helped me, but I think growing up with parents that were, you know, successful and frugal, and that probably helps quite a bit.
During the era you were with the Bills, I lived in Western New York. I was coaching at Rockport State, and I was also consulting with Buffalo Sabres, so I was in Buffalo a lot. I've never seen a situation where a community actually worshipped a professional team as a community in Western New York, and how fervently they were behind the Bills at that time. It was almost like a religious fervor. I'm wondering what effect that had on the team, or did the team not even know that it was different than other NFLs, because I've been in other cities where they don't worship a team like they did the Bills in Western New York.
I think the players
perceive that. Did they understand that?
Yes, because so many players come from other places, and they knew. You know, because first off, you are in a fishbowl there. One of my buddies says, he tells a story of when we went out grocery shopping and people just stop and stare and they watch and they follow you around. And you're blind to it because it happens so often that you're kind of blind to it. But the players feel it, the players knew it. And then that's what I loved about when I actually went to Kansas City. I was like, wow, this is like a college town. They love their team on Sunday, they barbecue, they have a party, and then they don't know who you are the rest of the week. It's gone. In Buffalo, the factory shut down the rest of the week if you lose. I mean, it's like, oh my goodness. And the radio and the whole thing, it's a religion. So, we're well aware of that problem.
What's the coldest game you've ever played in? And being from Southern California, how do you deal with the Buffalo cold? And if you wear sleeves?
All right, so let's start. I'm from Huntington. I go to Arizona and I get drafted to Buffalo, and I own one pair of pants. I own three or four pairs of shorts. I don't own any shoes outside of flip-flops other than my cleats. And I get to Buffalo, and on May 16th, we have mini camp and it snows. And I thought, oh boy, I'm in trouble. I was freezing in May, and everybody's laughing at me. I'm like, all right. The coldest about my third or fourth year in the league, we had back-to-back games at -38 below wind chill. And that's so cold. To give you a perspective, my wife, who would refuse to sit in wives' sections, meaning because the wives would go to the wives' room, she goes, if you're out, hold on up. She would get a beer before she could get to her seat, the top quarter inch or so was frozen. That's cold. That's really cold. And my beard would be ice, and no, I didn't wear sleeves. Unwritten rule, well, it's an embarrassing rule, it's an embarrassment factor. And now it's kind of gone, it's out of the league. That time, linemen, we would berate you. You would pay huge fines if you were a lineman who wore sleeves. And I didn't wear them. The reason I didn't wear them is because, you know, they're real tight, and they look good. Well, I have new arms. Mine would be loose, you know, and they'd grab it. So I had function behind not wearing them, rather than just the bravado of not wanting to pay a fine. All right. Hey, thank you so much. And, I want to say that I remember once being in Buffalo Stadium, but I drove up from that other city where people are kind of blood about football in Pittsburgh, one other town maybe, Dan, to see Carlos Santana. So I was sitting in the sun. That's my experience with Buffalo. Okay. So, ladies and gentlemen, please give a warm thank you.